How does our country get the name Bharat? So in Vishnu Purana, this beautiful shloka comes. Uttaram yat samudrasya himadrechaiva dakshinam varsham tad bharatam nama bharati yatra santatihi. Where the Himalayas are on the north, samudra, the ocean, washes the feet of the mother India, and that land where people revel in knowledge, that land is Bharat. And the descendants of this great land are called Bharati. So ours is a very glorious land, most beautiful culture of ours. Landmass exists all over the world. But what is so special about this land? For thousands of years, great masters, great scientists, mathematicians, logicians, artists, they have built a beautiful, glorious culture on this land, which helps us to rise from the human to the divine. And it is a very holistic culture. The beauty of this culture is it does not tell us to escape life, it tells us to embrace life. It tells us how to face the challenges of this life, become successful, attain success, glory, wealth, prosperity, abundance. Do all this in a very dharmic way, with righteousness, and finally discover fulfillment, the absolute bliss and permanent happiness that all of us seek. It's a land of the great rishis. And when we say rishi, we should not imagine only people who are, you know, renunciates, who have a long beard, who are living in the forests. But rishi literally means one who is a seer, who has a subtle perception. And this is the land where we have discovered knowledge in various fields. When we think of Bharat, what is the first picture that comes to your mind? You can answer in the chat. Indian map, the flag, land of God's flag. All right. Tradition. It should be picture, huh? Not just some words. Food. Yeah. Map with various cultures. Wonderful. So tradition, culture, geography, that comes to our mind. But when we think about India, science doesn't come to our mind. Management doesn't come to our mind. Technology doesn't come to our mind. Because it has been programmed in us that this is only a land of culture. This is a land of culture plus science, plus management, plus art, literature, everything. We have attained the peaks in all these fields, not only in the past, but also in the present. Just yesterday, I was seeing that video that 1 year back, what people spoke about India, that COVID crisis has hit the world, India is going to suffer very badly, and what all rumors were being spread. And 1 year down the line, we are exporting the vaccine made in our country, being friendly to so many of our neighbors also, sending aid free to so many other countries out there. So for science, technology, we still don't have that pride that we belong to a country, we belong to a culture where all this is blended so beautifully. So this vision we must have very clearly, and we are the youth of this country who are more than 70% of the population of this country. So we are the future of this country. The vision of the future can be molded by us only when we have the right vision in the present moment, and we have pride about who we are. When we know who we are, what is our glory, what is our identity. For that, it is important to know our past, understand our present, and then look ahead for a grand future and work hard for it. I always quote this beautiful line of Dr. Abdul Kalam in his book, Ignited Minds. He wrote so nicely. He said, "We are the links of a great past to a grand future." Such a beautiful line that is. Great past. We have had a great past. Many people say, what is the use of talking about the past? It's like saying, what is the use of knowing who my father and my great grandfather is? I don't care about any of them. We would not exist without them. Their legacy we are having today, and we can carry forward that legacy to much more glorious heights. Our Gurudev Swami Chinmayananda used to always say that a person who does not know the roots, where he comes from, which family he belongs to, what is the glory of that family, will not have enough strength in life to live uncompromisingly. Because survival itself is such a challenge for that person who doesn't know, who has no idea about his family and his roots, who has to face so many brutalities and challenges in the world. But someone who knows that I come from such a glorious land, such a glorious family of mine, these are my great ancestors, these are the great things that they have done, they will have tremendous strength not to fall for the temptations, for the distractions, and they will have that capacity and the vision to look ahead and build a grand future. So we must have the knowledge of the past. We need not have only the knowledge of the past and keep beating about the glory of the past. It is one part. In fact, Vivekananda said beautifully that he who teaches about the past to anyone is doing a great service to the country. What he meant by past is the past of the country. He who teaches about the past of this glorious land is doing a great service to the country, because we have been great. We are great even now, and we will be great even in the future. That self-belief as a nation is very, very important. There is no country in the world which has survived attacks of more than 1,000 years, and we are still here living culture. And even right now, the attacks are happening outside and inside, both tremendous attacks are happening. Still, we are who we are. We have not let go of our values. When we say Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, the whole world is one family. Today, in this crisis of COVID also, we are still giving the vaccine. We are still serving the countries. We sent hydrochloroquine when the COVID situation was there last year in March. The lockdown, etc. To so many countries, we have exported medicine. Indian pharma companies have been doing that. IT companies have been serving so beautifully. Many fields, if you see, our country has been doing a lot, even in terms of food, even for the relief in many, many countries, the UN aid, India does a lot. But none of this we become aware of. So what was our glorious past? How glorious we were, you know. People say that if British were not there ruling over us, we would not be educated, we would not have railways, we would not have postal service, we would not have the English language, we would be completely backward. But that is far from the truth. When British came to rule our country, India's contribution to world GDP was more than 25%, and Britain's contribution to world GDP was less than 2%. In 200 years, the amount of wealth that they drained from this country, they funded their industrialization. And our contribution came down to less than 3%. That is what the British did. And they did all this for their benefit. They did not build railways for us. They built railways for their benefit. All their goods were being imported into our country. Raw material from our country goes out there, they make it, they import it back, they export it back, and we import it here. We were funding every single thing. Their railways we were funding. None of the Indians were serving in the railways. It was the British who were doing everything, right from the engine master to the TC collector to everyone. So if you actually look deeper into these facts, a lot of brainwashing has happened to us. So all the more it is very important for us to know what was our true past, how glorious things our great grandfathers have achieved. Look at the temples that we have built, look at the art which is there, look at the literature, look at the dance forms. Which country in the world has such rich variety of dance forms? In one dance form also there is so much of depth and variety. In Bharatnatyam itself, how many poses are there? Then Manipuri, Kuchipudi, Odissi, whatnot. Any field you take up, spiritual field, we were at the top. Economic field, we were at the top. Sea trade, we are taught Vasco da Gama and this Columbus they are great sailors. Columbus landed up in a wrong place. Searching for India he was, but landed up in some other place. Our people have been exporting many, many thousands of years before. Cholas used to go in this, use the sea route in the Southeast Asia also. The biggest Hindu temple in the world, Angkor Wat, is built by the Cholas in Cambodia. We used to export spices to the East, to the Middle East, including to Britain also. So whether it is sea route, whether it is management, whether it is economics, whether it is mathematics, even science, the amount of discoveries our country has made in science in the past is just unmatchable. And even today, again, if I have to give you the recent example of Covaxin, COVID vaccine, our vaccine costs only $6. And look at the price of other vaccines. Pfizer vaccine is $70. So people have to understand this. We have to all understand this fact that what made the country so great is the land where we have worshipped knowledge. We have worshipped knowledge more than comforts, pleasures, conveniences, luxuries. No doubt enjoyment is one part of life. But great work can happen only when there is sacrifice. Sacrifice of selfishness. Sacrifice of attachment to pleasures. When our focus changes to service, when our focus changes to being a contributor, when our focus changes to being an instrument to make my country rise high, to make the field in which I am, the subject, I must make paradigm shifts in that field. That should be my contribution. When that vision comes to us, then we will become great. And we are already on the way to becoming great once again. In just a few years, we were down. Again, the trajectory is going up. We are ascending once again. So the knowledge of our past, with the pride of that, with the glorious knowledge of that, this is who we were. This is our identity. Nobody can take away our identity from us. If somebody takes away that identity from us, we have lost the most important thing. And in last few decades, that is what has happened, that we have forgotten who we are in the name of pseudo-secularism. We have forgotten our true identity. The reason why different cultures exist today peacefully in this country and we coexist is because of the Vedic culture, where we say everybody is welcome. There is one divinity which pervades every heart. Plant, animal, bird, human being, everyone, there is one supreme truth. Tujhme Ram, mujhme Ram, sabme Ram samaya hai. Kar lo pyar jagat mein sabse koi nahi paraya hai. This is our country. Ram I am using just as a symbol. It could be any form. It is absolute formless also. Our country has respected the inherent divinity of everyone. And hence, the culture which is founded on this spiritual basis, the spiritual culture of this country is the identity of Bharat, the core competency of Bharat. And that is the reason why people across the world look up to Bharat for this spiritual knowledge even today. And our knowledge of science, arts, culture, literature, everything is based on the spiritual foundation. So this vision we must have very clearly, that where there is spirituality with prosperity, that is the beautiful balance. And I am not only saying that. Dr. Abdul Kalam himself said it in his book Ignited Minds, when he gives points for how a developing nation becomes a developed nation. The first point he wrote in that is, integrate spirituality into education. And today we are going away from that in the name of being so-called secular. Hindu culture is inherently secular. And this land is the land of the followers of this Vedic culture. And that is why everybody is coexisting peacefully here. If we let go of that, there will only be anarchy. In the name of secularism, we will land up in a completely different kind of a state. We, the youth, must have the clear vision that this foundation of our culture is spiritual knowledge. And this spiritual knowledge enables us to become compassionate, kind, to put aside our egos, to work for the country. Today, one of the biggest challenges that we have is we don't have we may say unemployment and all that, but at the same time the challenge is that there is not enough skilled labor. There are not enough people who can say country before the self. That is our vision, and which is what we must create, the healthy patriotism, the healthy love for the country in the minds of all of us, that we become contributors and we say nation above self and sacrifice what is required to make the country great. The first color of our flag is saffron. Saffron is the color of sacrifice. Sacrifice what? Sacrifice selfishness. Always think first, will this benefit my country or not? If this does not benefit my country, then somewhere I'm going wrong. And as a youth, am I preparing myself to be a direct contributor to the country? I will also prosper. Nobody says that you will never prosper and only you have to sacrifice everything for the country. My prosperity is not to be neglected, but my prosperity, I cannot stop with that. And for that, I cannot compromise. That is the ideal that our forefathers have lived. Not compromising with the country, not compromising with quality, not compromising with selfishness. Keeping this ideal is how they lived. They achieved greatness, and that is what we have to do even today. Know the glorious past, become aware of certain beautiful achievements of the present, and have a grand vision for the future. Wish you all great success, great happiness. Let us be great and make our country great once again. Jai Hind. Hari Om.